Jesus as a body. So we're people that we want to be marked by that. We want that to be visible throughout the week as we gather with each other in small groups or one-on-one in discipleship, and that as we come here together corporately as a body, we will be worshiping Jesus. So we're so glad that you're able to join us today. I know there's been some issues with live stream, so that may be up, it may not be. There's been some issue with the technology there. So please excuse us with that for those at home. But wanted to start out with some announcements, the first of which would be the men's local retreat. So not able to go up to the mountains this year, unfortunately, but we will be gathering on November 21st. And so we'll have more details to come for that. There will likely be a morning session and then an evening session. So stay tuned for that, but also if you're a man and you're here or listening to this, please mark off November 21st, that's a Saturday. That'll be just a really sweet time for the men of this body to gather and to look at what it means to be a man in this body and to worship God and have some fellowship together. Also, the Christmas care packages, I know it's a little bit early, but since we have missionaries that we've sent across the world, on the other side of the world, we need to get a head start, and the missionary care team has done a great job leading that up. So be on the lookout in the coming weeks for the little Christmas tree, which will have gift tags on them, and each gift tag will be assigned to one of the missionaries that we care for. So you can pick one of those up and then go in and get that item that you're green to get for them. And Randy Williamson will be leading that up, so thank you, Randy, and if you have any questions or want to be involved in helping with that, please reach out to Randy. And then also, the Fall Festival, this is we're getting to partner with Grandview Baptist for this. This will be on November 1st from 4 to 6. And so we're tentatively planning on doing the trunk or treat that we usually do and use this for a time of fellowship as well. So more details will be coming out for that. But again, that's November 1st. And it might be worth joining the planning team or reaching out if you have any ideas about how to help that or want to help out in planning with that. There's definitely some room for that, and we'll be considering just different ways to keep that socially distant and healthy in that sense too. Also, this week, this is most pertinent for the women, on the 15th, that's this Thursday at 7 p.m., there will be the Women's Bonfire, and that will be at 7 p.m. at our home, actually. And the bonfire will have s'mores and just a time of fellowship with the ladies. So please come on to that if you're a woman and here or listening or know other women, invite them. That should be a sweet time of fellowship for the women. And so now if you would please stand with me for the call to worship. This is Psalm 25, 1 through 5. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you, I wait all the day long.
Thank you. introduce today's speaker. Most of you probably know Cameron Ramsey, but in case some of you, especially coming in with our live stream, in case you haven't met Cameron, just wanted to introduce him. As, pretty sure this is the first time he'll be speaking here in Midlands, right? And I got to know Cameron several years back. I was sitting in a church history course with him. We really didn't get to know each other, but I remember thinking, well, there's a studious young undergrad chap over there. He looks like he's paying attention. And since then, I've actually gotten to know Cameron. And yes, he is a studious young chap, which is why I'm excited that he's going to be preaching to us this morning. Cameron is a guy who loves God, loves God's Word. And so far as I know, handles God's Word accurately. So I'm just kidding. I love Cameron. I'm really excited that we're inviting him to come and preach this morning. And he served for a couple years recently doing an internship at a church. And then Cameron also served on Residence Life at CIU the year before I worked with Residence Life. So anyways, I'm excited to have him. Cameron, thank you so much for the preparation you put into teaching this morning. We're looking forward to that. Let's go ahead and pray for a few items. Let me announce, though, real quick, that first, Ryan and Brittany Petrie had their baby this week. Jonathan Thomas is the name. Hold on, I made sure to get a birth weight and all of that good info. 7 pounds, 10 ounces, and then 20 and a half inches. Congratulations to you guys. And then also we want to keep the trailers in prayer. They're going to, Lord willing, be having baby Joel this week. So let's be praying for them and health for mommy, for baby, and just a good week for the whole fam. And hopefully next week we'll be celebrating with them as well. Let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with gladness in our hearts that we could come together and worship you. Father, you are worthy. Father, we thank through your word, the testimony of your word, the wondrous things you've done in creation, in your people Israel, through Christ at the cross and in your church today. And Father, we just marvel at who you are and how you work and the immense love that you have shown to us. And so we worship you this morning, and we attribute that you alone are worthy. Father, we give you praise because you're worthy of praise, and we are thankful for the ways that you have worked in our lives and transformed our hearts and minds. We invite your Holy Spirit to continue that work this upcoming week in the ways that we think and act. Father, please help us to yield our lives to you and to truly allow your Son to be Lord of our lives. Father, we want to lift up the Petries and thank you so much for a healthy delivery there, Father. Please bless them with peace and comfort and grace as they acclimate to a new arrival, Father. And please prompt us as their church family to know how to best encourage them and provide for them, so that they feel very well cared for and well loved this week and in the weeks to come, Father. And we want to lift up the trailers, Father, and just ask that you would bless Vanessa's health, especially this week as they prepare towards the delivery, Father. We pray that you would go before them in their circumstances, that you would make their path straight, so to speak, would coordinate this delivery, that it would be a healthy delivery and a cause for much celebration and joy. Father, we pray now that as Cameron opens the word to us, most of all, that our ears would be tuned in to the truth of your word and to your actual words that you've given us, Father. We want to hear your voice this morning. And so, Father, we're thankful that Cameron has been willing on our behalf to go ahead of us and prepare this message and to consider what you're saying to us in this passage. And I pray that as we leave this morning, that we will be challenged to trust you more and to follow in obedience and to continue to worship you in our hearts. Father, we commit these things to you in your son's name. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and do the scripture reading as well. And we're going to be reading from John 11, 1 through 27. You can remain seated. That's okay. John 11, 1 through 27. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was the Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. So the sister sent word to him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. But when Jesus heard this, he said, this sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. Then this he said, and after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go so that I may awaken him out of sleep. The disciples then said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he was speaking of literal sleep. So Jesus then said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him. Therefore, Thomas, who is called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, so that we may die with him. So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. Martha, therefore, when she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him. But Mary stayed at the house. Martha then said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even he who comes into the world.
I'm ready. The kid's already been dismissed. Okay, cool. Just wanted to check. Well, good morning, Midlands Church. I'm glad that you could join us today, whether in person or if we have the online stream going, or if you happen to be listening to the podcast later on. I'm glad that you could worship with us here, at least in spirit. I want to start just by saying that I'm excited for what God has for us this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, let me start by asking a question. How many of us have young children or have had young children at one point in your life? Okay? I have not. I am just simply raising my hand to show you that it's okay. You can also raise your hand. But what is the question that young children love to ask most as they start to grow and get older?
Why?
What was that? Why? They love to ask why. They want to know how the world works. They want to learn more. They're just growing and experiencing. And they'll ask the randomest questions too. It'll be like, why is jelly sticky? And you're like, because it is. And they say, but why? And you say, because of what's in it. Why? Because that's how it's made. Why? Because they take fruit and they smash it up and they get the juice and they take that and boil it with sugar and pectin and whatever else you do to make jelly. I don't know exactly how it's made, but then you take it, you cool it down, put it in the refrigerator. refrigerator, it solidifies. When it comes out, it's delicious, but it's sticky because it has the sugar and fruit juice in it. Why? And you're like, I want to pull my hair out right now because this child is driving me insane. Well, I also have found myself asking the question why a lot recently. As I was reading and preparing for this morning, I just kept wondering, why did John give us this story that we're reading at this point in his gospel? Why did he give us this story at all? Why even write his gospel? And I think it's maybe a lot like a child who draws a picture. Have you ever had a child draw you a picture? Right? So what they'll do is maybe you have a girl who draws this picture. She's young and she wants you to see it. So she comes up and she gives it to you, and then she'll run away. Or maybe she gives it to you and sets it in your lap, or reaches up to hand it to you, and she just waits there expectantly after you take it. And she's wondering how you're going to respond. Or you might have the young boy who's really extroverted, really outgoing, and he comes in and he's drawn this picture and he wants you to see it. So he holds it up and he says, see, look. And the point is to get your attention, to draw you in and to show you what he's drawn. I think John does the same thing in his gospel, in the purpose for writing it. He's a lot like that child who drew the picture and is trying to show it to me. And sometimes I think, you know, if you were to look at that child and say, what do you want me to see? What are you asking? Maybe if the child was a bit older, a bit more mature, they might say, duh, it's right in front of your face. I put it right out here for you to see. It's nice and obvious. I think John would probably say the same thing to me as I've been asking, why this story? Why here? Why did you write your gospel? I think he's like, Cam, duh, it's right in front of your face. I was wanting a lot of the depth, the richness. There's a famous theologian, and I can't remember who it is at the moment, but he said, Scripture is shallow enough on the one hand that a young child could wade in it and not drown, but at the same time, it's so deep that the wisest and most studied theologians can dive into the depths and explore it and not reach the bottom. And I was wanting those depths. I was wanting to jump in. I was wanting to say, it can't be so obvious and so right on the surface. And I think it is. Does anybody know the most common word, the most common theme in John's gospel? Belief. It's the idea of believing. He uses the word 100 times in 21 chapters. John uses the word believe. And my favorite part is actually at the end in John chapter 20. It's so beautiful, so rich. In verses 30 and 31, John says, now Jesus performed many other signs to his disciples. And then you can almost read the subtext in between verse 30 and verse 31. It's like he's saying, but just in case I wasn't clear enough, in case I need to spell it out for you, and then in verse 31, he says, but these things were written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. I think John would look at me and say, Cam, you're over here trying to be in the deep end, and I just made it nice and shallow. I wrote my gospel so that you may believe who Jesus is. And that ties to the entire Gospel of John together. It pushes the story forward. It weaves this narrative. It's at every point, every turn. And so let's keep that in mind as we jump into our passage today, John 11, 1 through 27. He wrote this, he gave us this, that we may believe in Jesus, and by believing we may have life in his name. So, we'll jump in. John 11, I'm going to start with verses 1 through 6. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick, he's dying. Come quickly." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness won't end in death. No, it's for God's glory, that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus, to be clear, loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Pause with me for a second. I beg of you, please don't be the reader who says, "I know where this story is going, and it's incredible. Something amazing is coming." Don't anticipate what's coming, but stop for just a second, and let's pretend we're reading it for the first time again. And then we don't know the end. There's so much here that I think we can miss if we jump ahead and try to just follow the story along to where it's going as opposed to waiting in it and realizing what John has for us in this passage. Can you imagine? Martha and Mary's brother is dying, he's sick, and they send word and they say, "Jesus, come quickly, the one you love is dying, he's sick." And then when they needed Jesus, they know he can heal. They've seen his signs and his miracles throughout. When they need him most, he's not there. Now, a little background. If you remember in John chapter 20, verse 30, he tells us that Jesus performed many other signs to his disciples. Well, that's a key theme in John's gospel. Also, is his signs. Jesus performs 8 signs throughout his gospel. The first one is in John chapter 2 when he turns water into wine in Cana at the wedding. And each time the signs increase, they get a little bit greater, a little bit more powerful, it's escalated, it's more serious, it's more hopeful. But the first one is for life and joy and fulfillment. He's at a wedding feast, and he turned water into wine that they may enjoy it, that they may love their time there. And we're told that it's the sweet wine, the good wine. Jesus cares not just about life and giving life, but he cares about our enjoyment of it as well. And then in John chapter 4, we have the second sign. He heals an official's son. And this was a little bit more serious. At this point, you have a young boy, a child who's sick and hurting. And he's probably been sick for a little bit of time. Maybe not too long, we don't know. But Jesus heals him. And it's this claim of "I have power to heal and to give life as well." And then in John chapter 5, we get the third sign. Jesus heals a lame man, one who's been paralyzed for a long, long time. This is maybe a little bit more serious than the sickness of the young child. But short, at this point, we have a man who's been lame and not able to walk for a long time. And Jesus heals him. He says, "Take up your mat, go and walk." And then in John chapter 6, we get signs number 4 and 5. So while at first he was dealing with individuals in signs number 2 and 3, at this point we get the feeding of the 5,000. And all of a sudden, Jesus moves from one person to many. And he gives them food. Think Matthew chapter 6, where Jesus says, "Don't worry about what you're going to eat or what you're going to drink. Your Father in heaven knows that he'll take care of you." And I think sometimes maybe we could miss this, because we today have grocery stores available to us everywhere, and we have restaurants all over the place, and fridges and pantries that are constantly stocked with food. So it's not as much a worry in our eyes and in our minds about where we're going to eat or what we're going to have next. But to somebody who's poor in first century Rome, to the poor Jews there, they may not know where their next meal is coming from. Jesus takes these loaves and these fish and multiplies them, so that 5,000 men, who knows if there were women and children there too, could be fed. And then he makes this next claim that's kind of crazy, kind of wild, in John chapter 6, where he's walking on water. And this is a big moment for them, because in the Jewish mindset, the sea is actually this monstrosity. It's uncontrollable. It's something that will overwhelm you and consume you. You have absolutely no control over it. Rivers and streams, that's one thing. those may not destroy you. In fact, they're fresh water, and you might be able to drink from them. But the sea, that's salt water. That doesn't provide it. If you can't drink that, and it will consume you, it will overwhelm you. It's depicted throughout the Old Testament as this scary and overwhelming thing. And Jesus comes along and makes this claim of, I don't just have power over life and over healing, but I have power over nature itself to walk on the waves, to walk on the water, and it doesn't consume. And then we get the sixth sign in John chapter 9, where he heals a blind man, one who has been blind from birth. And this is crazy because nobody's ever seen this before. Nobody's seen a blind man be healed, someone who's been with this condition their entire life. And Jesus demonstrates his power over that too. And then John chapter 10, he makes this claim. He says, I am the gate, and then he says, I am the good shepherd. And I thought Aaron's question from a couple weeks ago was wonderful. It helped me see this in a little bit different light. Because the next thing Jesus says after he says, I'm the good shepherd, is he says, and the good shepherd lays his life down for his sheep. And Aaron asked, how is that a good shepherd? Wouldn't that leave the flock unguarded? They're unprotected now without someone to guard them? And that's a good shepherd? And Jesus goes on to say, nobody takes it from me, but I lay it down with my own accord. I've been given this authority by my Father. I lay it down and I take it up again. And there are two responses from the Jews right after this. There are these two camps. And on the one hand, right after Jesus made this claim of, I have the power, not just over life and healing, but I have the power over death. There's one camp of Jews that says, they say, how could this be? I'm paraphrasing here. They look at what's in front of them and what Jesus has said, the promise and the claim that he's made, and they say, you are insane. This guy has to be demon-possessed. There's no way. He has the power over death itself. Not a chance. I look at what's in front of me and what life has given me, and I don't believe. Because it's too crazy. But then there are the other Jews. Do you remember what they say? They say, but wait a second. Didn't he just heal a blind man in chapter 9? This doesn't make sense. They don't see how he could have the power over life and death. We can't understand and comprehend that. But I saw what you did earlier, and I believe not just that you can do it again, but I believe that you can do greater things based on the claim you're making. Two camps. And the first camp, those who don't believe, actually go to the Pharisees, and they talk to them, and they stir people up. And they decide, we're going to go stone Jesus. So they go to kill him. They go to stone him. And at the end of chapter 10, Jesus says, all right, I'm out. He knows it's not his time, and he leaves. He gets away from Judea. And this brings us to the beginning of chapter 11. Right after Jesus made this claim over life and death, right after he's nearly killed, and he leaves, we're at chapter 11. So let's read again. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick and dying. When he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Now, to be clear, Jesus loved Mary and her sister, Martha and her sister, Lazarus. So, therefore, because he loved them, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was two more days. How does this make sense? Then he says to his disciples, hey, let's go back to Judea. And his disciples were like, dude, they just tried to kill you. You know that, right? And you want us to go back to Judea? They're going to kill you. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It's actually when a person walks at night that they stumble, because they have no light. This is a bit of a confusing metaphor for me at first, but I think I've started to pick up on what John is doing here. He introduces Jesus as the light of the world early on in his gospel. Jesus is the light coming to light our way. And what Jesus is saying here is that you guys, you disciples, are actually looking at this from the world's perspective. You're seeing that people tried to kill me, and that they didn't want us there, and so we left, and you're saying, if we go back, they're just going to kill you. They're going to try again. But what he's saying is you think you see by the light. You think you have the light from this world light in your way, but really you're walking in darkness. You think you won't stumble, but actually you will stumble because you're in darkness, and you need a light to be able to see and show you the way, and if that's okay, I am that light. That's why I came. I came to give you life and to show you the way that you may have life. So come on. Come follow me. After he said this, he went on to tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. And his disciples replied, Lord, if he's asleep, he's going to get better. We know he's sick, but when you're sick, you sleep, and then you get better, and you wake up, and it's going to be okay. And Jesus says, no, no, no. John lets us know they were thinking that he meant literal sleep. But Jesus says, let me make it plain and clear for you. Lazarus is actually dead. And actually, for your sake, I'm glad that I wasn't there so that you may, what? So that you may believe. There's that theme. But now, let's go there. And then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of his disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Thomas and the disciples, you see, they're still thinking. They're still looking at things through this world's light. They can't see what Jesus is doing or saying, and quite frankly, they might have no way to know what he's getting at. But they're thinking, Jesus is about to go back to Judea, where he was just killed. He gives us this weird metaphor and then says to follow him anyway because Lazarus is dead, so we need to go with him. Because he's going to die, and we should die with him. They can't see, but Jesus is their light, and he'll show them the way. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, pause again. This is an important moment, and there are two things that I want to say here. The first thing is it might be tempting to think, now wait a second. Jesus waited 2 days. That seems kind of bad, but then Lazarus was dead 4 days. So really it wouldn't have mattered if Jesus had gone or not, because Lazarus was already going to be dead by the time he got there. So it's not a big deal. 2 days isn't a big deal. But I would say, wait a second. Because in John chapter 4, when he heals the official's son, he wasn't there. The official comes to Jesus and he says, hey, my son is sick and he's dying. And Jesus responds to him, go, your son will live. And we're told the official goes back, and before he even gets to the house, his servants run out, and they say, your son, the fever is broken, your son is well. And he asks about it, and he says, when did this happen? And they say, yesterday at this time. And the official realizes, that is the exact moment when Jesus told me my son will live. That's the kind of power Jesus has. He doesn't even have to be present. And he can provide the healing. So yes, Jesus waited 2 days, but he could have performed the healing even from afar. And yet, not only does he not do that, but he waits 2 entire days. The second thing to note here is that the 4 days is pretty important. Because in the Jewish culture and in the mindset of the time in first century Rome, there was this thought that maybe if it had been under 3 days, then this guy may not have actually been dead. Maybe he was just in some kind of coma or asleep or something, and he woke up. And so does Jesus' miracle actually carry that much weight if he hadn't been dead for 4 days? But Jesus waits intentionally to get to that four-day mark so that everybody knows there's not a chance. This guy's dead and gone. Like, the tomb smells bad. No way. Could this have been anything except a miraculous work of God? Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Don't read too much into that, It was actually customary at the time for people to come in comfort at the house. And then if one person were to leave, somebody has to stay at the house. It does two things. First, it's to be present, to be with those people who came to comfort. And second, is to show that the family is actually in mourning. You weren't supposed to leave the house and to go on with life or anything like that. It's a cultural way of expressing we are grieved that a family member has died. Unless you were to go to the tomb to actually visit the tomb itself to see the deceased or to weep there. So Mary stays at home, and then Martha comes to Jesus and she says, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know, even now, that God will give you whatever you ask. This is a powerful statement of belief, but I don't actually think that Martha was expecting Jesus to raise Lazarus from the dead. I don't think that's what she's asking. Initially, I did, but upon reading it again, with the conversation that follows, I think it becomes clear that she's asking for something else. Maybe she's asking for comfort from Jesus, maybe for something else. We don't know for sure. But if she had been expecting or asking Jesus to raise Lazarus from the dead, something she hasn't seen Jesus do yet, according to John's gospel, then I don't think she would have responded the way she does right after this. Read along with me. Jesus says to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha says, I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Now, if she had been asking and expecting Jesus to raise Lazarus, I don't think she would have responded by saying, I know he'll be raised in the resurrection on the last day. So I think there's actually something else going on here. I think Jesus is trying to connect with her on something that's known and bridge the gap into the unknown. He's taking this small statement of belief of, I know that God will give you whatever you ask, and he said, that, I can work with that. Let's run with that. You may not have the faith of what's going to happen, but that's okay. You don't have to know everything. Again, because Jesus says, I'm the light of the world. So he says, your brother will rise again. And I think he says this intentionally. He knows what Mary's thinking. He knows her thought process and her beliefs and everything. And I'm not even necessarily talking specifically. She just would have been a part of the common folk. The common Jewish folk of the day would have actually probably followed the Pharisees, the Pharisaical sect. I'm not saying that Martha was a Pharisee, but rather the Pharisees were the ones who ran the synagogues. They were your average leader in terms of worship and piety, and they explained to you the law of the Torah, the Old Testament, and they would help you to follow it and live it out. There are some other sects of Judaism as well. It's kind of actually a lot like Christianity today. I think you've got Pentecostalism with beliefs that are going to be a little bit different than traditional Reformed and Reformation beliefs, and then you have Catholicism and Orthodoxy, and there's all these different groups that all think some things a little bit differently. Well, Judaism was kind of the same way. We had the Pharisaical sect, but then you also had the Sadducees, who are also mentioned in Scripture. And these were more of the political leaders, maybe, the ones who were kind of buddy-buddy with Rome. And they had a lot of political power, and they were the ones running the temple. And then you've got two other groups. One of them was like, all right, we need to not learn how to live within Rome as the Pharisees did, and in the diaspora, the exile into the nations all over the place. They learned to make life there in the synagogues. The Sadducees still had the temple, and they were kind of working with the Roman government. And then there's this group that says, no, we don't need to be a part of that. We actually need to overthrow the Roman government. We need to reestablish our own kingdom, reestablish Israel, because God came to us and he worked with us, and our kingdom is the one that he wants to work with. And then there's a fourth group, and they're like, we're out. We're not supposed to be a part of this world. We're not supposed to be involved with this. So we're actually going to go live in the caves in the desert. We would rather do that than live in Rome under your rule. And they just leave entirely. Martha, as I mentioned, is going to be a part of this group that would follow the Pharisees' teaching. And a common belief at the time for the Pharisees was that there was a resurrection at the end of times, a resurrection in the last day, that God is going to raise up his righteous from the dead and give them life and eternity. And this is what she's believing. And Jesus says, I'm going to connect with that right there. physically activates it. He takes what's known and then bridges the gap to the unknown. Watch this. He says, your brother will rise again. And Martha says, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. That resurrection you're waiting for, that you're hoping for, I am that. I provide that even now. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And then he says, Martha, do you believe this? And at this point, I think Martha has this option, this opportunity. She can go one of two ways. It's kind of similar to those Jews in chapter 10, you remember? The Jews who were faced with, does Jesus actually have the power to do what he's saying, this power over life and death? And one group says, this is too crazy, I don't believe. And the other group says, this is crazy, but I've seen what you did before, and I'm going to trust that you can do it again. And so I do believe. Except Martha's situation might be a little bit different. Maybe it's not the power of Jesus that she would be tempted to doubt. Because remember, back at the beginning of chapter 11, when she and Mary called for Jesus and they said, we need you, our brother's dying. Come, he's sick. And Jesus wasn't there when they needed him most. They know the signs he's performed. They know what's happened throughout John's gospel. They know that he healed a young boy without even being present. And Jesus chooses not to. Maybe Martha's temptation is that you don't have the power to do what you said, but rather, you don't have the personal involvement. You don't actually care, Jesus. She could look back, kind of like that first group of Jews, and say, I don't believe. Not because you don't have the power, but because you don't care. We prayed for you before, we asked for you, and you weren't there when we needed you the most. But she doesn't take that route, does she? Verse 27, she replies, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world. Martha looks at her circumstances and what's in front of her, and she says, I don't know how this could make sense exactly, because we called for you and you didn't come. You weren't there. You weren't present. There was this period of waiting, and yet I'm going to believe, because I've seen what you've done before. I've seen that you do actually care for people. I've seen that you are involved. That you've healed so many and performed so many signs that John's already shown us in his gospel. And as he said, there were many more things Jesus did. And so in the face of what doesn't make sense, Martha says, I do believe. I think John is inviting us here to see that perhaps we face this same question. Maybe every day. Are we going to believe? I think that a lot of us, myself included, fall into one of two camps very regularly. Either we think God doesn't actually have the power to do this thing in my life, he can't actually have control over this, or we believe he doesn't care. He's not present and he's not there because I called and I asked for him before, and even though I know he has the power, he wasn't present, and he didn't do it. I don't know what it is that you may be facing, whether a relationship, spouse, your family, job, finances, career, even personal growth, down to the smallest details. It could be what we as a church collectively are facing, Midlands, or the church across the globe. It could be the state of our nation right now, with everything going on, and really all of human history, right? Whether we're an individual, or part of a group, or the whole human race, it's so tempting to say, God, you don't have the power to do this. This is too great for you, like those Jews in chapter 10. Or to look at it and say, God, you don't actually care. I asked and you didn't come, and you didn't show yourself. here to help you see that Jesus actually does have the power as he claimed in chapter 10. He claimed power over life and death itself. He said, I will lay my life down and I will take it up again. And I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but remember I said there are 8 signs? Well, we went through 6 of them. And they increase in severity each time. We've got 2 to go. One of them's coming up next week. And then we're going to get this big pause. John gives us 7 signs in 11 chapters, and then we're going to have a pause for about 7 or 8 chapters before he introduces the 8th and final sign, when Jesus actually does lay his life down and take it up again. And that's when he showed the most power he could have ever shown, and that's also when he showed the most care he could have ever shown. When he said, I love you, every one of you, so much that I'm going to give of my own life, and I'm going to take it up again. Jesus does have the power, and he does care. Sometimes we may have to wait, as Martha did. We may be stuck in that 2-day period. I don't know how long your 2-day period is. I'm sure it felt like a really long time for Martha and Mary. And maybe you're in the midst of a long, dry period where you're just waiting and asking, God, are you ever going to show up? Do you actually care? But I'm telling you, he does, and he can handle whatever's in front of you. The question he asks us, just as he asked Martha, is, do you believe? Do you believe that I'm powerful enough? And do you believe that I'm present enough? Even in the waiting, even in the hurt, that I'm there, and that I'm coming to make things right. Do you believe? Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for the example of Martha, of somebody who is stuck hurting and waiting, not knowing if you're present, not knowing if you do actually care. Thank you for the example of those Jews in chapter 10. Some of them, some of whom didn't believe you had the power, but some who said, I've seen you do things before and I'm going to trust and believe you can do greater things because you've said you can and you've made promises that you will. God, help us, show us those areas in our own lives that we believe either that you're not powerful enough or that you're not present enough, and be the light of the world for us. Light our path and help us to believe and to trust even when it seems crazy, even when it seems wild, even when it looks like you can't control it or you don't care enough to be involved. Pray that you would encourage every one of us today to know that you do care, and that you are present, even down to the smallest details of our lives. Would you bless us today with a relationship with you and with a relationship with one another? Would you lead us together toward life and fullness and joy as you take us toward and even now into your kingdom? We wait, Lord, for you to return one day to take us home. Amen.
Jesus, praise the mountain, fix the wall.
15:13. May the God of hope fill you with joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope.